love to see people out there just congregating and doing our thing, right? Isn't that cool? I like that. Good morning, church. Let's all stand. Let's worship the Lord together. Let's get something to get our blood pumping.
Good morning, New Hope. I made it back. I'm glad to say that I did have a negative COVID test. So if I'm tired, I'm just getting old. Okay, not the virus. That's the good news, I guess. Happy birthday to Jenny today, by the way. She tells me she's 49, I think you said. Number of events in your bulletin. Next week, we start out with the men's ministry, kind of a meet and greet, I call it, okay? We're going to be at the Anderson compound, which is north of town here, a couple miles. And basically, it's just an introductory meeting where we're going to do just that. We're probably going to be shooting some guns and eating some meat. And Jim Metzger is going to take his famous smoker. He's got this giant smoker, and he's going to make a whole bunch of meat. And so it's just a way for us to begin to get to know each other as men. We kind of, Jim and I have come up with a slogan where we gather, we grow, and we give and serve. And so we're just kind of getting focused. We can't let the women have all the fun. That's what we decided. You know, the men need to be having some of that too. So that'll be happening the coming Saturday. Then next Sunday evening, we're going to gather at 6 o'clock here at church to begin to discuss the book that we have by Francis Chan that many of you have been reading. And a rumor, and I just want you to know, I am looking for roadkill, and I do plan on making some chili for that as well. If I get the appropriate roadkill, we'll have some chili. So I look forward to that. That book, I trust it'll stimulate some good discussion as we kind of look ahead as a church and just seek God's vision. I noticed a sign up. I see Diane's not in here. Oh, yeah, she is. I see a sign up sheet out there. Is there something you need to say about that? Donna needs to say something about that.
For those of you who weren't here last Sunday, we're going to have a big birthday bash June 13th. And the sign ups are there. You sign up the month you were born. And I said, like last week, you know, mine's August, so you can't all be in August. I get to share it with Bill, and there's a few others. But you do have to do the month that you were born. And that's just a way for us to fellowship with different people. You know, spouses will be split up. You know, it's just going to be a good time to get to know everybody. I would like you to sign up, though. That way, if there's only one on one month, you know, they won't be by themselves, and I can combine some tables. So sign up if you can. If you, you know, don't get a chance to sign up, still come. We don't want anybody left out. So please come and have a birthday bash with us.
Sounds good. By the way, I talked to Paulette this morning, and Bob is beginning rehab this morning. So that's good. I take that as good news, though. Technically, he has a long way to go. He's still very weak, and his speech is slurred, and so there's still some question marks there, but he's going to be in Mattawan starting rehab, and so I'm glad to be able to report that, which reminded me, we've been talking about getting Zoom. Yes? Okay. Okay, thank you, Joyce, for sharing that. Need to pray for Bob, for the cancer as well. That Bob had, he had cancer. You might not know that, but he's a cancer survivor from a number of years ago, and they're concerned that that may be back. And so a lot going on with Bob and Paulette. We talked about having Zoom for prayer meeting because of the virus and everything, so it kind of forces our hand. You know, I'm not real technologically savvy, so Mark's going to help me. So I hope that maybe this Wednesday, or if not a week from Wednesday, Bob was always in prayer meeting. He was one of the faithful prayers. And I thought, man, we have to enable him to be able to be there through Zoom. But if we're doing it for him, we can do it for anybody. So just so you know that it won't be long, and it might end up, because of Zoom, it might just be me by myself here, you know, make it too easy. It's still nice to gather, but for those who can't, for whatever reason, we hope to get that with Zoom, maybe for Sunday school as well, because Bob was part of the Sunday school as well. So we're going to try to get technologically up to snuff here. A couple other things in your bulletin, Meals for John. I can sign up for that as well. And as we help him also with what he's going through. So any other announcements that I missed there? Let's pray together as we continue to worship God this morning. Father, we thank you today for the gift of life. Father, we gather to be reminded of who you are and who we are before each other as well. I pray you'd bless our time together and give us great joy in worshiping you. And I pray you'd challenge us as well in the very deepest part of our soul that we might live more truly as your children. So just use this time, the music, the prayer, the preaching. We offer this time to you now in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, let's bring some joy in the house of the Lord today. Let's stand, let's worship together. go. Corinthians 5, verse 17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. And the old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. All this is from God through Christ, reconciled us to himself, and then gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting us with the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us, Now, I will implore you that on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God.
I'll praise you for amazing grace. Up from the grave, up from the grave, into the dark, you called my name and brought me back to life again. I rose with you up from the grave. All praise and all praise, all praise. See, the old life is gone and the new has begun. Your name always. Jesus, you alone deserve all. Church, let's sing this together. Sing praise to him. Sing all your praise to him, because you are good. Sing praise to him. Sing all your praise to him. Sing praise. Sing all your praise to him. All praise and all praise, all praise. See, the old life is gone and the new has begun. Your name always. Jesus, you alone deserve all. One more time. And all praise, all praise. See, the old life is gone and the new Jesus, you alone deserve all praise. Jesus, you alone deserve all praise.
We're going to go back to that last verse there, Dean. Let's sing.
You're coming soon. You're coming soon. Your promises, they all come true. God, we will fix our eyes on you, and we believe you're coming soon. Yes, we will fix our eyes on you. Your promises, they all come true.
Be seated.
Morning. Last week we talked about being fearfully and wonderfully made. And today I'd like to expand on that verse. And I want to show you how close our relationship with God is. I'm going to read from Psalms 139, verses 1 through 16. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know me when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to obtain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee your presence? If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. Excuse me. If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there, your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me, and the light becomes night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like day, for the darkness is light to you. And what we talked about last week, for you created me in my innermost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know full well my frame is not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place. When I was woven together in the depths of the earth, your eyes saw my unformed body. All these days were ordained for me before it was written in your book, before any one of them ever came to be. God has known you before you were ever born, and he'll know you forever. Not even your best friend knows things that God knows about you. And that said, you cannot hide from God. You can hide from man in the darkness, but you can't hide from God. God's there. And when you go places that you should not go and do things you should not do, you're taking God there with you. Isn't it reassuring that when you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, that he is there to comfort and strengthen you? He is with you always. He wants to bless you always. What a wonderful and merciful God we serve. Let's pray together. Lord, this morning we bring before you our brother Bob Green. It's a mixed blessing, Lord. We hate that he had to go through what he had to go through, Lord, but we've already seen answers to our prayer, Lord. Like we talked about last week, we pray with confidence that everything with you is possible. Pray for John Baer. Pray for Michelle Albin, Chuck Hansen's friend, who has inoperable liver cancer. We pray for Janet Anderson's knee problems. For Dylan Johnson, for healing for the COVID. Pray for Jeannie's friend, Diane Kellogg, who has pain and swelling in her leg. For Gary Myers, Sarah's son-in-law, who has cancer and a blocked artery, and a new tumor was found. For Jeanette's friend, Jessica B., who has health issues. For Sharon Lovely, a new attendant here. For Chris Mays in rehab, who has thoughts of suicide. We pray that, Lord, you would intervene there, Lord, and that you would strengthen him and bring him back and know that he is a loved and beloved child of you, Lord. For Rachel Raymond Gunderson, for her psoriasis and recovering from the COVID. For Tanya Spears with lupus. For Ken Resliff, has cancer and blood clots. Another friend of Jeanette's, Heidi, for her diagnosis of the long-term illness. For Heather and Goebbels, friend of Judith Johnson, needs prayer, diagnosed with stage 3 throat cancer. For Cindy Behrman, for her breathing issues. For Todd Scoven, which is good news, it's a praise. His tumors have shrunk and some have even disappeared. Again, the power of answered prayer. For Heather Ward, who has breast cancer. For Chuck Hansen, his internal problems. For Chuck Kuiper, and leukemia. For Crystal, that you would give her freedom from alcohol. For Jeannie Franklin, unspoken. For Don and Donna Bailey, their unspoken request. And we pray that Kristen and Jesus Vega would be able to get back to their ministry. Well, Lord, we come before you knowing, without a doubt in our hearts, Lord, that with you anything is possible. You are the great physician, and nothing is impossible with you, Lord. We lay our concerns before you knowing that you hear all prayers, Lord. We just ask that you would act on these that we're praying for this morning. And we have loads of good news and praise next week. We ask it all in Jesus' most holy name. Amen.
Let me just say first, I'm very grateful and thankful that I was able to go help my daughter Rachel and her family with the virus, that I was able to be there. And I was exposed to the virus, but I had a test, took a test on Thursday, I think it was, got the results yesterday morning. The test came back negative. So I'm just so thankful that I was able to be there. And thank you to the elders for giving me the flexibility to do that. 1 Timothy 5:5 says that, you know, if a family, if you don't help your own family, you're worse than an unbeliever in a sense. And so it's kind of what families do. You know, my daughter was having difficulty breathing. And when it got to that point, we said, you know, we're not gonna stay here. We didn't want to both go. We didn't want both of us to die of the virus or whatever. So I thought, hey, it's the man's job, you know. So I went and very thankful to be able to do that. I have a picture of the crew here that I was involved with while I was up there. That's my daughter and her children. You can see the handful that she has with those kids. But it was a real privilege to be able to be there with them and to be able to help. And so I'm very thankful for that. It really was a dangerous you know, you think of it as a dangerous time, you know, going up and risking the virus and so forth and that. But I want you to know it wasn't the only thing that was risky going up north. There were other dangers as well. One of them is the bear, you know, out of the shack. I saw all the sign of a bear, so I put my trail camera up and I put some meat and some things out. And sure enough, there's a big bear was coming by the shack there. I'm guessing 250 to 300 pounds. And so kind of a creepy thing, you know, to be going out there to get my trail camera, knowing that all I had was a machete with me, okay? That's all I had. And knowing there's that big bear out there. But, you know, I decided to do something a little bit different. I decided to make friends with the bear. And so I actually found out that bears are not, they're like big dogs, okay? I simply had to let the bear know that I was not food, okay? Food, no, not food. Food is over here. So we really became good friends, and I was thinking of bringing it back to kind of take the place of Pumbaa, but it didn't work out. But anyway, a lot of danger up north. Now, I'll be honest with you, the biggest risk of all that I took was not the virus, was not Bruno, the bear, but the biggest risk was this: teaching my granddaughter to drive. Now that, I believe that probably took at least five angels, had to go with us. We probably drove 100 miles. I drove all through the backwoods of the UP. Ironically, I think it must be, I remember I told you years ago I got stopped by the police for going too slow. Apparently it's genetic, because I had a hard time getting her to go fast enough, but we drove for miles and miles, and I got her to the point where I wouldn't call her safe to ride with quite yet, but she's learning, and so it was a privilege. And family, it's what family does, doesn't it? You know, at our best as family, we're there for each other. Do you know in the Bible, the church is described as a family as well? It's really a powerful image, isn't it? That we have our biological families, but we also have a church family. And that's who we are as a church. We're family. We see this in the words of Jesus in Matthew chapter 12. We listen there to the words of Jesus, and he says this in Matthew 12, verses 46 through 50. Excuse me. It says, while Jesus was talking to the crowd, his mother and brothers stood outside wanting to speak to him. And someone told him, your mother and brothers are standing outside wanting to speak to you. And he replied, who is my mother and who are my brothers? Pointing to his disciples or his followers, he said, here are my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother. And so there Jesus begins to describe his followers, those who would follow Jesus, as part of this family of God, where God is our Father and we're brother and sisters in Christ. That's who we are. We're God's family. And that becomes one of the major pictures of what the church is. We're family. Ephesians chapter 2, we hear there the words of the Apostle Paul. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 19 through 22. He says, consequently, you are no longer foreigners and aliens, but fellow citizens with God's people and members of God's household or God's family. Built on the foundation, I just have to read the whole passage. Built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. And in him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. So you see a number of metaphors for the church family. There, we're a building, we're a body, but we're a family. We're God's household. If you look a little bit farther in Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 and 15, we see it again. The Apostle Paul says, for this reason I kneel before the Father, from whom his whole family in heaven and on earth derives its name. Tells who we are. We're the family of God. Do you know in the Bible there's 59, in the New Testament there's 59 one another commands, where it talks about we are to, and what are some of those? We're to love one another. What else is there? We're to encourage one another. We're to bear with one another, to comfort one another, to exhort one another, to forgive one another. And it goes on and on. And there's 59 of those where that is the life of what you might call a family. And we are the family of God, and we relate to one another. In our church covenant, which we haven't read for a while, but it's back there and there are copies of it, We're reminded of this, that the very first line of our church covenant says this, that we members of New Hope Fellowship of Southwest Michigan hereby covenant with each other before God, and here's the line, to be family, to be committed to each other, to love, accept, and forgive each other until death or until God's call causes us to part. And then it goes into the rest of all the specifics of how we strive to relate to each other. But it's right there that we are family. And that's what we are committed to. There's so many blessings of being part of a family, isn't it? And there's overlap here as we talk about our biological family, yet our church family. I mean, within families, we encourage each other, we support each other, we help each other, we challenge each other, we listen to each other. So there's all these one another, all the things that go on with the family. Francis Chan talks about that in the book Letters to the Church, which we'll be talking about next Sunday evening. He talks about that. He says, how can you be part of a family if you only get together once a week for an hour? And he talks about that. It really is more than that, isn't it? In a sense, God's design is not just that we gather, though the corporate worship when we gather together, there is a special thing that happens when we gather with the whole church family. And it's really all through the history of Israel, New Testament as well. It's an important time. But the church is really more than that, isn't it? I mean, to really be a family really takes more than just this, doesn't it? It really does. One thing I really enjoyed being up north in the time, because I was there for a number of days, was spending time with the grandkids. But I haven't normally been able to do a lot. And by spending time with them, things happen. Discussions happen. When I was taking Aaliyah, a driver's training, we saw an eagle. And I asked her, I said, have you ever seen an eagle before? And she said, no. I got to be with her to see her first bald eagle. What a great memory. I taught Marcus I taught him to skip stones. Nobody ever taught him to skip stones. So I taught him to skip stones in the lake. We grilled steaks. They'd never had grilled steaks before. So what a privilege to be able to do those things. We were having a discussion where the girls were telling me that, yeah, this neighbor down the street, this guy's in jail. And apparently this boyfriend had stayed with this girlfriend, had abused some of the children down the street. And he was in jail now. They're telling me about that. And I said something. I'm not sure if this is right. But I said to them, I said, you know, I said, if anyone ever touches you like that, you tell them that your grandfather's going to kill them. I said that. Whether that's right or not, whether I overstated that, I'm just being honest. That's what I said. You tell them your granddad's going to kill them. So we had a chance. They know now that they got somebody who's not going to tolerate that kind of stuff with guys in their life, you know. And so those are the kind of discussions that happen with family when you spend time together. It's the way it is in the church family as well when you spend time together with each other as well. I was reminded of the privilege of biological family as well. Last on Mother's Day, I was quarantined, and so I couldn't be at church. I wasn't here, obviously. You guys were all eating bacon and stuff last Sunday. And the next picture I have is where I was. I went to the family cemetery and saw in my mother's and dad's grave. I just thought about family. In the same cemetery where my grandparents are, my great-grandparents, and just thinking about their life. And I've told you before that, you know, coming over in 1873, working in the mines of the UP, working in the logging camps. My grandfather had to quit school. In the eighth grade, he had to wrap up school because he had to go to the farm. And just the legacy and the heritage, again, at the best of what families are, of what we received. And just the interconnection of our stories. It's my story, you know. It's my family. I'm part of that. This is true in the church as well. You know, when we gather together, it's all of our stories intersecting with each other. And so we have this big family with just all these incredible stories that now we're part of. Because it's my brother. You know, my sisters in Christ. And stories of Bob here. Bob Van Vliet, I got to wake up Bob here. I see those eyes starting to close. He helped me put the roof on our house. You were like 90 years old back then. And he was up on top of our house, roofing, putting the roof on our house. What a great time. What a great stories. And they had a dog. And then Jamie, had the dog there. Just the stories that we can tell of being part of a family and being part of a church family. What a wonderful thing it is. The people we can get to know. And just the influence that can happen. The people that we can bless in the people that bless us. That's all part of what a church family is. I was also reminded, though, how difficult it is to be part of a family as well. It's also very difficult. And the other picture I have, and by the way, I was planning on doing this by video, and so I'd gone through all these places I was going to go and videotape to do a sermon, because I didn't know if I'd still be, have the virus or still have to quarantine or whatever, So these are kind of like what I was going to do if I would have done video, but I was just ready to be back. I'm just ready to not be. And videotaping is hard, But I was reminded of how difficult it is. And there's back at the, Nathaniel and Matthew, where I put their ashes and built those crosses for them, and where I go spend time. I think it was Woody Allen that said, oddly enough, that to love is to suffer. And when you're part of a family, you risk lost, don't you? You risk having your heart broken. And that's true in the church family as well. Our hearts will be broken. The only way is to just isolate yourself and not have any kind of family or not be part of any church family or anything. And then you're safe. How many of you are tired of being safe? Amen. That's one of the things I think with the virus. Caution, we've had to think that through. There's a place for being cautious, but life is not safe. And we're not going to be safe. And we will get our hearts broken. So it's difficult to be part of a church family. It's difficult in other ways as well. And it's easy to give up on church. I was talking to somebody this morning about some people kind of like just watching a video feed. Maybe it's okay to just stay home and watch a video. Maybe it's easier to do that. It's easy to give up, isn't it? Because we also are going to disappoint each other. We are going to fail each other. We are going to hurt each other. Within families, that happens, doesn't it? And within church families, that happens. I was thinking about that. And I'm going to test here your age. We're going to find out what generation you're a part of. And so when I was thinking about, we're gonna disappoint each other, we're gonna fail each other, we're gonna hurt each other. So you gotta name the rest of the lyrics of the song, okay? This is a song, this is a test. We go on hurting each other. He got it, the Karen Carpenter. We go on hurting each other, and then what's the next line? Making each other cry without even knowing why. How many of you remember the Carpenters? Yeah, you do. Yep. We go on hurting. You didn't get that quite as quick as I thought we had. It's funny, that song just popped into my head. We go on hurting each other because what happens, isn't it? Galatians chapter 5, verses 14 and 15. The Apostle Paul, and he's talking to the church here. He's talking to Christians. And he says this. He says, the entire law is summed up. It's summed up in the single command, love your neighbor as yourself. If you keep on biting and devouring each other, watch out or you will be destroyed by each other. He's talking about the church there. We can do that. As Christians, man, we can hurt each other. And we do. We can fail each other. Disappoint each other. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. The Apostle Paul there, he says this. Again, he's talking to the church there. He says, brothers, I could not address you as spiritual, but as worldly, mere infants in Christ. I gave you milk, not solid food, for you are not yet ready for it. Indeed, you are still not ready. You are still worldly, for since there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not worldly? Are you not acting like mere men? That's the hard stuff. That's why church is, as wonderful as it is,
That's how difficult it is as well. You know, there are empty seats here where there's people that used to sit there, and they're not here anymore. Whether they were hurt, whether they're unhappy. And I mean this when I say, I'm going to let God judge, you know, whether I, you know, maybe I just failed them. Maybe they were just unhappy for some reason. I don't know. You know, only God really knows that. That's hard, isn't it? It's hard when people get upset about something or don't like something. Yeah, the sermons, you know, they aren't so good or whatever. I don't like the elders, you know. Or, you know, you get these different things. And okay, well, it's hard. That's why church is so hard. And that's why the Apostle Paul says that we have to forgive one another. And that's the beauty. It's the potential for beauty in the church where we have to forgive it. You know, families generally, you're kind of stuck with each other, right? But not totally, because like divorces, you know, things happen that families get alienated as well. But in our day at churches, it's so easy. So easy just leave, you know. So easy just go somewhere else. And sometimes God leads us elsewhere for purposes. And again, I leave the ultimate interpretation to God. What I'm just saying here is it makes it difficult, you know. It's hard to say, to have, you know, conflict or say goodbye to people. But yet, we have the opportunity to forgive. And that's part of the beauty of the grace of the church. God sets the bar really high for us, doesn't he, by using the word family. By calling the church a family, the bar is set right up here. I mean, it's really high. When I was in high school, I was a high jumper for a while. I say for a while because it didn't last long. My vertical jump was maybe like this much, you know. So I jumped like 4 feet, you know, and other guys would jump like 6 feet. Bar is really high. When we talk about being family, you know, the ideal of life together as a church family, to really live that is setting the bar really high. I mean, just think about that, what it looks like. Again, in all of our brokenness and our weakness and our sinfulness, to try to do life together as family. Just think how hard that is. What does it look like? I mean, this some things that it looks like. It's praying together. You know, we pray together and for each other. We have Bible studies together. You know, we have conversation. We eat together. With my Baptist background, of course, eating together was a big deal. We had potlucks, you know. We listen to each other. We get to know each other. And then importantly, we do mission together as well. We do things together. You know, we find ways to serve God in mission trips or outreach or whatever. We're trying to do stuff together. We spend time together. We suffer together. You know, we rejoice together. Just that doing life together. Just what a beautiful thing that is. But what a difficult thing that is. Because some people, you know, the temptation is, I just watch it on TV. You know, I don't want to be part of that, because it's hard. But yet, what a high bar that God has set. So the challenge for us as New Hope Fellowship, as we move forward, as we come out of this pandemic, and as we enter into really a kind of a new chapter of our church life as well, may we embrace what's written in our very covenant itself. May we embrace the challenge of being family, and of being God's family, in family with each other. You know, one of the challenges of that, of course, is part of what a family is when you have a family, there are certain boundaries there that make you part of that family. You know, for me, the Gundersons, the Shelton, you know, we have a name, and we have our biological family that we're part of because we're kind of born into it. But with the church, we're the family of God. We're born into it by being born again. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. And we accept Christ as our Savior. We become part of the church family. We have these boundaries. But yet at this very same time, we are called to have this open front door where people can join our family. I've heard people talk before about, small town dynamics. How many of you grew up in a small town? It's like if you're in a small town, you never really become an insider. You're always an outsider. Churches can have that same problem, is where, you know, it's just really hard to get in where you become an insider, you know, become part of that church family. It's one of the challenges is to make sure that even as we're family and we're tight and we love each other, we're watching out for each other, that we have that front door that is open so others can join the family as well and become part of this great family of God. And to not lose that, where we don't want to slam that door and say, you know, this is good enough. No, it's not good enough. You know, God would have us reach people and have that open door so other people are able to be assimilated in or become, you know, become part through, let's call it adoption. So we're able to adopt people, you know, people are being adopted into the family of God. May we be that kind of church. Amen? That kind of church. We're really ready to just welcome. Again, there are boundaries there. I mean, you have to commit to Christ. We're not just a gathering of undefined people of whatever. No, we are followers of Jesus Christ. We are committed, and then we commit to each other as well on that basis. May we be that kind of church. Family of God with an open front door. And hopefully the back door will be kind of hard to get through as well. Hebrews chapter 10, verses 24 and 25. The author of Hebrews says this. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. And I think meeting together is not just Sunday. It is that. You know, Sunday we gather for this corporate worship that is a profound part of what we do. But meeting together, to pull weeds in the yard, you know, to drink coffee together, to eat together, to do something, you know, to eat meat together, to whatever, study the Bible together, pray together. Let's not give up meeting together. Being careful, you know, with the realities like we have now. You know, Jesus came to this earth. He lived a perfect life. He died on the cross for our sins so that we could be a people for his name. To make the church. It was the joy that was set, speaking of joy, it was the joy that was set before him, having a people for his name that kept him, that motivated him to die for our sins so that we could become a people for his name. May God help us moving forward to be that kind of church. That's what Jesus did for us. Let's recommit to being family, to be the family of God. What does that mean today? You know, today, when you leave this place, you go home, we kind of re-enter, you know, we come here, we're reminded of who God is, who each other is, get to see Kirby, you know, and then as we re-enter the world, what does it mean? I just want to encourage you that as you go home today, start with your biological family, say, you know, maybe there's somebody in my family that I'm alienated, or I haven't forgiven, I haven't talked to in a long time, maybe just call your family, call you and say, you know, I've been thinking about you, I miss you, just talk to your family. And then secondly, think about your church family. Maybe there's somebody in your church family that you say, you know, their seat's empty. I haven't seen them. I'm going to give them a call. I'm just going to say, how you doing? And when I say that, I really want to hear about it. Because usually we don't have time, do we? When you say, how you doing? Fine. It's kind of true, you know. But we don't always have time to really lay it out, do we? We need like an hour, you know. You're like 6 hours, you know, to really talk about how you're doing. But maybe today, when you're not part of, just one-on-one, there's somebody you can call and say, how you doing? And it'd be great to listen a little bit and find out. Maybe they'll say, how are you doing? And we get the chance for our stories to kind of intersect and begin to merge together. It starts with that kind of choices. You know, we can talk about this, or we can do it. God help us do it. It's very easy to just not do it, isn't it? May God help us to be a family. Be the kind of family that has that wide open front door where people can be welcomed in. That's not perfect here. We're not going to be perfect. But just that there's something, that God is at work here. There's something attractive that people want to become part of this family. And may God use us toward that. Because the world needs churches like that, doesn't it? The world needs us to be that way. Pawpaw needs us to be that way. Lawton needs us to be that way. Mattawan needs it. They need us to be a real family of God. God help us to be just that. Worship team, come. come at this time. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you again for the, most of all now, for the gift of spiritual life, that we've been born again, that we can aspire to such a high bar that's been set for us, to just honor, to love you, to love our neighbor, to love each other. I pray you'd help us do that. We're so weak and broken. I pray that by your grace, we would be able to be a family and just to be able to love each other. So we just thank you again. We thank you for Jesus and all he did for us. We pray this in his name. Amen.
Let's stand and let's remember what Christ did for us. I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and all alone. Thank you.
Amen. Let's give a shout to the Lord. Tell him how good he is. Hallelujah, church. That's what a family does together.
Before the benediction, I was remiss. I'm sorry. I merely meant to thank all the guys that helped last week with the breakfast. I think they did an excellent job. And two things. One, I want to say that I drove my sister nuts. Several weeks before, I told her, I said, every year before, I put out sign-up sheets for the guys to help. And I always only got like two or three people sign up, but then came the day, we had plenty of help. I said, so this year, I'm not putting out a sign-up sheet. We're just going to do it, and I'm going to trust God they're going to be there. And it drove her nuts. Finally, about 4 days before, she said, you know, you should call people that you think are going to come and just tell them and remind them that, you know, maybe they should be there and stuff. And I said, no, they'll be there, you know. And thank you, guys. Thank each and every one of you for doing that. And the other thing I thought of when Pastor Tim was talking about that, we were reminded that in past years, Tom, who sat right over there, used to come and take our picture, the cruise picture that helped, and then gave all the guys that helped a copy of that. So he had a reminder. That was a really nice thing. And I hadn't thought about Tom in a long time. I don't know what happened to him. So, you know, that's right on. But thank you, guys. Appreciate it.
You know, we were, thank you, praise team. That was just wonderful worship today. During that last song, a woodchuck ran across the backyard here. And I said, Jeff, I said, hey, chili for next week. No, not swans, no. Let's pray. Father, we thank you again for the gift of life. And just thank you for all the blessings that you sustain us through the hard things, too. We're not in heaven yet, and we know that, Father, but we're so thankful. And thank you for the joy that you do give us. And as we go from this place, I pray you'd help us to give it away, help us to pass it on. And just thank you again in Jesus' name. Amen.